there, guys. Ken here, your Thrifty Apprentice, and welcome back to another Thrifty Review. So we are going to be taking a look at Marie's Masters Watercolor 12 count tube set, which I picked up from my local Jerry's Autorama. Now, the very first part of this video is going to be a painting demo where I'm doing a rainbow teacup set. I wanted to do something that was going to really kind of show off the color, the saturation, vibrancy of the paints for a final painting demo right before I offered my final reviews on them. So that is exactly what we're doing here. So basically, I, in normal process, sketched out my illustration on a piece of regular just copy paper. After I got it the way that I wanted it, I then transferred it to my watercolor paper by simply flipping the illustration over and scribbling my pencil on the back of it so that I would have a light transfer onto my watercolor paper. I tend to use that technique instead of tracing paper just to keep the lines light. I'm painting on Maya 100% cotton watercolor paper. No, I take that back. I'm sorry. I'm painting on New York Central 100% watercolor paper. Again, another product I picked up from Jerry's. New paper for me, just been introduced to it here in the last couple of weeks. I'm actually liking it, and it's really economical. As you guys know, that I'm making the switch to 100% cotton papers. So I am testing out a lot of different brands in order to, you know, find ones that are really budget friendly, but still really high quality. And this one has not disappointed so far. But the God honest truth is, I haven't had many qualms with any of the 100% cotton papers that I've been trying lately. They're definitely a step above any cellulose paper you could possibly use. Depending on the composition and the situation. So you already know that I'm using the Marie's Masters watercolors in this particular composition. Guys, I've been having so much fun using these paints. And I'm glad that I have been. Since that little catastrophe that we had with the Five Below paints, I really wanted to get a paint that I really liked and a paint that I could offer a really good review on. And when we get into the review section, you guys will get to see, you know, how these paints truly perform when you break it down. Now, this is a really detailed painting. I had to really take my time. This is a sped up demo, of course. So you guys are only getting about 12 minutes here, whereas it probably took me the better part of about an hour and 15 minutes to paint this painting. It was really detailed. Now, the reference photo that I used was actually a outline of a teacup stack from clip art on the internet. So it was sort of a drawing outline, so to speak. So I was just able to kind of look at that particular outline and see the details that were in the teacups and then just kind of translate that onto my paper. You know, I've been really trying to practice lately on growing and pushing myself on painting things that are a little bit more in depth and in tune, or maybe a little bit more complicated than the normal paintings that I do. Not that I'm going to take away from the simplicity that I have on the channel, because that's what it's for. It's basically put there to give you something easy and fun to do and, you know, kind of learn something here and there if possible. I'm not the best artist in the world. I've never proclaimed to be, and I definitely don't know everything, but I like to learn, I like to grow, and I like to share what I learn with the people who are interested in hearing it. So that's what this channel is for. It's funny, I had a comment on Facebook really recently from one of the watercolor groups that I was in, where actually one of the administrators or moderator or owner, one of them, whoever it was, made a comment on one of the posts that I made in some feedback from a rejection, actually, that my paintings were simple, and that they all look the same, and that I should watch some professional videos in order to try to grow. Now, of course, I know everybody is entitled to their own opinion, and I didn't take offense to that, and much respect to that person if that's what they see and that's what they perceive. However, I'm an avid believer that art is self-expression, not their expression. I've never proclaimed to be a professional. I've just claimed to be somebody who likes to learn and likes to share what I learn. That's been the premise since the moment I started this channel. So I don't know how that may have been intended. I know how it could look, but with whatever that may have been, I did exit that group. I did not feel like that feedback was constructive more so than just insulting and negative. And I did not feel like that was an atmosphere that I needed to be a part of, the exact opposite of what I tried to push for the Thrifty Apprentice sponsored Facebook group, Paints, Pencils, Pastels, and Markers. So yeah, I didn't feel like that was an environment I needed to be a part of anymore. So I did make a quick exit, but I don't hold any hard or residual feelings. And I'm definitely gonna get something positive out of that, and that being this. I didn't need you to tell me I wasn't on a professional level. I'm aware of that. I'm striving and I'm working every day to grow and to become a better artist. And I think that in time and with practice and the consistency that I've had, I'll get there. In the meantime, I'm going to continue to present what I've learned, what I do, what I know as I grow with anybody who may be willing to listen if it's going to help them out. That is my main goal. So if your mission was to put any type of dampening or negative spirit over me, what I do and what I present, then please be aware the only thing you did was to encourage me and push me to continue to go and to continue to strive. That's what we do as artists. So, okay, with that said, thanks. Okay, rant over, sorry. just kind of got off there for a second. It just popped in my head as I was talking. As you guys can see, this painting is really, really, really detailed. This, like I said, is about 12 minutes of your time. If you guys wanted to skip past the painting demo, I would completely understand, because I'm pretty sure at this point you kind of get the what I'm trying to portray with the way these paints handle. I was able to achieve really fine detail. And just so you guys know, that brush that I'm using is a number 4 round by Creative Mark. It's their Creative Expression brushes. They are absolutely fantastic. Golden Teclon, synthetic hairs, of course, acrylic handles. So if you happen to leave them in water, there's not a wood handle there to expand or to crack. Absolutely amazing brushes. I love using them. They are truly a workhorse. So I'm going to go ahead and finish up the green cup here. I'm just painting in all the details. Again, I'm just trying to make sure that I make each of the cups look different and stand out. I wanted them to feel really detailed but not complicated, if that makes sense. So that's what you're going to see me do, go through and finish up this painting. I'm going to also use some Master's Touch Fine Art Studio color pencils in here just as accent for my shadow and dark areas, some little outlining just to crisp up the lines on the cup. And then I'm gonna grab some gel pen and go in and do some highlighting. I went on and told you guys that because at this point, I'm just gonna cut out, let a little music play in the background for the remainder of this demo. And then directly behind the demo, we're gonna jump into the review of the Marie's Masters watercolor. So you guys stay tuned and enjoy.
Surprise, ever since I looked in your eyes, I had
So guys, here we are with the review section of this video. I did want to do that final demo painting and let you guys just kind of see how the paints performed before I jumped into this review. Done a few paintings with the paints now, and I think I'm finally ready to offer my opinion, you know, just from my perspective, keeping in mind that anything I said in this video is strictly my opinion based on my use of the product. So we've already done an unboxing video and a panning video. If you remember, this is the box that they come in. There's 12 original colors in the box for the Marie's Master's Finest Artist Quality, or Finest Quality Artist Watercolor. So this is their professional line of paint. If you remember, there was a color swatching guide on the back of the box. The tubes, because I did have additional tubes, just for your recollection, did look like this. And they do offer pigment number, color name, and light fast information for the paints. And we pan those up into this little DIY palette that I created from that Five Below set that I thought was, you know, pretty bad, to say the least. And we got a pretty nice dry down consistency from the paints once they were squeezed out. Well, the paints were of a pretty nice consistency when they were in the tube. There was no binder separation with the tubes. Nothing exploded on me. Well, I'll take that back. The yellow ochre exploded just a little bit. But other than that, the other of all the 18 colors, I didn't have any issues. Keep in mind that this is a made up palette. If you buy the sets, you're not going to get, I don't think they have an 18 color set. Just keep in mind that mine started with the 12 color set and I added additional tubes to get 18 colors, just so I would have the colors I really wanted to try. Let's see. The paints re-wet really well. No issue with that. I actually saved the palette that I had been painting on throughout testing the paints, just so you guys can see. There is like no chalkiness, no cracking. The colors are still vibrant and consistent on the palette from when I was doing the mixing. Now there's a little cracking there, but that was from a super watery. Had very little, it had a lot of water in it. But no, there is no cracking with the paints at all. Either in the dry down form nor from painting on the palettes with it. You're able to go back and re-wet that paint and use it over and over again. These are some really pretty and vibrant colors. Let's go ahead and take a look at the color swatching. Here. So I swatched them out on or in my swatch book, which is 100% cotton paper. This is an acid-free cold press paper. The colors were really pretty here. There is not a huge shift from wet to dry at all. They hold their vibrancy really, really well. There are some of them that have some characteristics to them, like for instance, the ultramarine blue does have a little thicker pigmentation consistency to it, and it does granulate. The earth tones do have a bit of a granulation to them. There are some pretty flat colors here as well. So you do have some different characteristics in the paints, which lend to them being more of a professional quality. Let's see here. Nothing really jumped out at me as odd from this 18 color selection. It was actually a pretty robust color selection in just a 12 color set. I mean, you get all of the colors that you need to pretty much create any composition. The colors mixed and blended really beautifully, which we're going to take a look at in a minute. The only thing that just kind of struck me as a little odd was crimson. It's PR 149, which was a color I wasn't really familiar with. I remembered seeing it one place, but I didn't recall seeing it in many different types of sets. And for this to be a crimson, it was, you know, it's sort of orangey. It reminds me more of a vermilion leaning color versus a crimson. Now here right beside a Winsor and crimson, you'll see the difference in that hue. You'll see how orange leaning that crimson is when it should be more of a red. You should have more of a truer red there. So it got me to thinking of where I'd seen that pigment number, PR149, and we're gonna get into that in just a second as well. But outside of that, nice color range. I didn't have any issues with the swatching. The colors are pretty transparent. Absolutely no sedimentation left on any of the black lines. They glazed really well. Even with the glazing, you get more saturation, but they still stay transparent. You're able to see the other layers that you used up under it. So I was really pretty impressed. Keeping in mind that I went into this knowing that although this is a professional line of paint, it's a really economical. So I was expecting it to perform more like a real high quality student grade paint. And I was honestly thoroughly surprised and pleasantly surprised that they gave me the qualities of what I know to be a professional brand of paint based on the professional lines that I've used. Now, they are not the most vibrant and saturated paint that I've ever used. They don't have the most granulation of a paint set that I've ever used, but they hold their own. They're really vibrant, and I definitely would not put these on the student grade level. Without a doubt, I believe that this is a more artist grade product. Now, let's take a look at some of the color mixing. So I did swatch them out again in order to go inside my tin so I have a reference. And I just have to go back through here and label, put the color names on here. But with that said, I did some color mixing. And I didn't do my little standard color mixing chart, but I just mixed the colors individually and then labeled them here. So here I was mixing the lemon yellow, and we're gonna have a sort of a primary color wheel here. I used lemon yellow, a Winsor and crimson, and ultramarine blue, basically. So here, lemon yellow and the Winsor and crimson gave me a really nice orange. Different from the shades of red, orangey reds that you were getting in the 12 color set. I was able to use the lemon yellow and the ultramarine blue to mix a really nice green. Again, different from the greens that are provided in the set. And it gave me more of an earthy, saturated tone than what's in the set. Not to say that you couldn't mix these colors to get that by adding a mixture of maybe, say, like yellow ochre, maybe even a touch of burnt sienna to just, you know, earth them up or a little bit more. Here was the mixture of the ultramarine blue and the Winsor and crimson, which was, again, a nice purple. These colors mixed really cleanly, and they gave you the secondary color that you were expecting to get from the mixture without being muddy or chalky in any shape, form, or fashion, and they still remain transparent. Here you can see that the granulation in that ultramarine blue causes, especially in that purple mixture, causes those pigments to split apart, and you're able to see the difference between the ultramarine blue and the Winsor and crimson in it. I think that is such a beautiful effect that ultramarine blue has. And not to say that most ultramarines aren't granulating, but I'm just speaking specifically to this particular brand of paint. Here I mixed the Prussian blue and the yellow ochre because I wanted to see what type of tealy green I could get. And based on the ratio, you get a pretty decent ratio of one paint to the other for depth and color. You get a pretty decent teal. I really, 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 really like that. And I've told you guys in the videos before, I'm starting to love Prussian blue more and more and more, and the colors that you can mix from it. Now here with ultramarine and burnt sienna, I was able to get a really nice gray tone, could mix even black from it. Again, that ultramarine blue caused the pigments to split apart, so you're able to see those blue particles in that paint mixture. Very, very beautiful effect. Salt test here. So salt test went well, as would be expected with most paints. Here I used a heavy consistency of water with a lot of pigment in it, and I just dropped regular table salt in it. Got a really nice effect that will be great for sand, underwater, snow, things of that nature. And here we're going to do the lift test as we always do with each other. So I'm just going to grab my scrubber brush really quickly and get it clean, or make sure it's clean because I don't think I've used it up until this. Grab a paper towel just to blot off here any excess water, and let's go in here and see if we're going to get any lifting. Now, this particular paper that and the color mixing and the salt and lift test is being done on is Universal Pad Mixed Media Paper by Creative Mark from Jerry's Autorama. You guys hear me talking about this paper all the time. I think it's a pretty great all-around paper that can be used for many things. Now here in this case, I don't know if I'm scrubbing too hard or what, but the paper is peeling a little bit. That's not a normal situation, I will admit. But with that being said, the paints are lifting off really well. As you can see here, I'm able to get that paint up. And this test was done well over a week ago when I put this down. So yeah, the paints will definitely lift, no problem about that. And you know what's funny is that I love a good quality paint that you can get both layering or glazing techniques that work wonderfully with it, but it'll also lift really well too. So it's so versatile in that aspect. I personally find that really appealing about a paint. So all of the tests that we normally do for the paints turned out really well. I am just thoroughly impressed, I must say. I have to be honest, for this paint to be so economical. Let's take a look at some of the artwork that I did with the paints. And before I do that, let me just say this about the pigments in the paints. The pigments in the paints are what you would expect for most of the colors. As I said earlier, I'm not really familiar with the Crimson 149. I've seen it before. I thought I'd seen it before. And we're about to jump into where in just one quick second. The sap green, I wasn't truly impressed with. It is a three color mixture. And this particular set does use PR101 and PY42 for their burnt sienna mixture, which I didn't really understand why most earth-based colors are made from really affordable pigments, yellow ochre, your burnt sienna, your burnt umbers, like so. I don't understand why it needed to be a two pigment mixture, why it couldn't have just been PR101. But it was an okay burnt sienna. Again, the sap green was a little disappointing. I've seen some much better sap greens in other budget sets, but that didn't take away from the overall quality of the entire set. Now the sky blue here is PP15. Now I'm pretty sure that color has some white in it, which is not listed on the tube. But there's no way they were able to achieve such that particular tone without adding a white pigment, in my belief, just based on what I know about paints. And I'll always make that point. Overall, everything else was pretty cool. You got your phthalo green, your PG36. Pretty standard for a phthalo green, depending on which shade leaning it is. Viridian, you have PG7. So, you know, not bad colors. The only one, again, that really just threw me off completely in left field was the Crimson PR149, which I had to go do some research. And in that research, I figured out where. Hold on one second. I had seen that pigment before. So I pulled out my swatch book and I started going through it. Now, as I was painting with the paints, I said, kept saying to myself that they had a really familiar feel to them. It felt like I had used these paints before. The quality seemed familiar, just better. Like, okay, this is a better brand of something that I've used. So the first thing I did is the first thing I came to as I was flipping through was my Winsor and Newton Professional paint sticks. And I kind of stopped and I looked at the colors and I started looking at the comparison. And then I started comparing pigment numbers. And I was like, wait, these pigment numbers seem really close to a lot of things that are in here. Now, pigment numbers are different, but the colors seem so close and so familiar. Like the Alenzer and Crimson, the Cad Red, which is PR255. You have the same thing here in the Marie's. You have the Windsor Yellow, and I didn't write the pigment number down for this. But if I'm not mistaken, it is PY3, the same thing as the Lemon Yellow in the Marie's colors. Now, I'm not saying by any means that these are the exact same. It's not. Now, what struck me as really odd was that the Yellow Ochre here in the Marie's is PY42. In the Winsor & Newton Professional paint stick is PY42 and PR101, the same pigment mixture that the Maries used to make up their burnt sienna, which we know the shade of a paint is based on the way that they treat a pigment. You can get a different color range from the same pigments. All right, so I kept flipping. I'm like, okay, that's very, very, very interesting. Very interesting. So I kept flipping, and as I'm flipping, I come across where is it? I have to go back this way because I'm sure it's in this book. At least I thought it was in this book, but here we go. The Winsor and Newton Cotton. Now, again, very similar with a lot of the pigments, but not quite as saturated and richy and punchy. So I was like, okay, so I don't think that they're cotton. So I kept flipping, and then I come across Phoenix, which again, we know uses the cotton formula. Well, we speculate, but we're pretty sure with that speculation that the Phoenix uses the cotton formula because they are so close. Again, really similar use of the pigment numbers. So with all of that joined, what I will say is that the paints remind me a lot, and I do mean a lot, of the Winsor and Newton line of products as far as watercolor paints go. So I think that's something to keep in mind if you're interested in these, because these are super, super economical. They are even cheaper, in my opinion, than the Cotman line, based on what I've seen the Cotman brand advertise as lately. Taking a look at some of the paintings that I did on the channel, you will find the Sweet Pea painting done. This was an ink and wash. I just kind of wanted to do a preliminary painting with them just to see what they were like, get a good feel for them. And this is when I first thought to myself that they reminded me a lot of Cotman, but with more punch, with more saturation, just a little bit more versatility. Seemed like the quality was turned up just a little bit. Really like the way that this came out. Really whimsical type flower. And like I said, it is a tutorial up on the channel. Now, this was done on the Maya 100% cotton watercolor paper, cold press, acid free. So this was a great first run for the paints. And they're very luminous. I love that. I love the fact that they are so pretty. Next, going up, I tried them out. I want to try some different colors using the yellows and the yellow ochres and the burnt sienna. So I did this floor vase arrangement. Again, was able to achieve the depth and tone and shadowing that I wanted. But the colors stayed bright and vibrant. They didn't get muddy. It was actually really fun. It was a joy painting with these. I was able to achieve some coloration, or to put some color in the white flower without completely turning it a different color, so that you understand that it was meant to be a white flower. It was nice, layered well, didn't lose the effect of the paneling under the shadow as I layered it here. I had fun with these paints. I really did. Lastly is the demo that you guys just saw, where I painted the what I call the rainbow stack. It is the rainbow stack of teacups. I wanted to be more detailed with the paints and use them in a bit of a mixed media setting, because I did add the addition of Master's Touch Fine Art Studio color pencils to this piece. They worked really well in combination with the paints, which was kind of a surefire proof to me, especially with the type of work that I do, that the paints will perform really well in conjunction with other products without losing their vibrancy. I was impressed. I was. Between the quality that I can see based on the pigmentation that are put into this particular set, I'm not sure about the bigger sets, and they do come in bigger sets. Keep in mind, I did add additional tubes, and from those additional tubes, I didn't have any real corms. Now, I'm pretty sure that there are some colors that can be omitted and that you could possibly do without in the entire range. To be honest, in this particular 18 set, there are some colors I could might could have done without that I can achieve by using the primaries and just a few of the convenience colors that may be already in the set. So that's kind of going to be the case with any paint set, I believe. But overall, for the quality of the paint, for the vibrancy and the color payoff, for the color transition or the lack thereof from wet to dry, from the fact that the paints will lift beautifully, react to salt, they mix really cleanly and beautifully. But the most impressive thing about this is that they are at one of the most economical price tags that I've ever seen a professional paint listed in the time that I've been on my YouTube journey as far as testing, reviewing, and putting out these particular videos. Now, I'm pretty sure there may be some people who have a different thing of opinion if they've used these paints. And of course, that's fine. That's what makes the world go round. I just want to offer my view. And my view is that these are some pretty outstanding, amazing paints. And I'm pretty impressed because lately I've been reviewing some more price-effective products that have been really good in quality, which lets you know that the market is wide open right now. Competition is high. And these art companies are under the pressure to give us better quality products and still not just rip our pockets completely apart. And I believe that the Marie's Masters is one of those products that fall into that ever popular growing category. So do I recommend the paints? I'm pretty sure you can tell from everything that I've said, I do. And here's what's funny. I am not being paid in any shape, form, or fashion by Marie's or by Jerry's for anything that I'm seeing in this review. I am truly, thoroughly happy that I decided to buy these paints. So much so that I've decided that these will be the paints that I will be buying on a continuous basis as far as just watercolor card making and those type of things. I normally use Genzei 10x, which I really love a lot for my card making and my journaling making, but these are definitely going to quickly go in combination with those paints. Although the Genzei 10x is a completely different beast, much more opaque gouache type paint. I think these are a great transparent addition for the type of work that I do. Let's talk price. So the only place that I was able to source the paints, as far as the normal places I shop, which are, let's see, Dick Blick, Jerry's Autorama, Amazon, and every Blue Moon AliExpress, which I'm sure they're available on AliExpress, but I did not look that up. However, they are available at Jerry's Autorama, which is where I picked mine up from. The 12 color set that I picked up was $34. It's currently on sale for $34.64. The list price is $41.99. They also offer a 18 color set. Ironically enough, I created an 18 color set, but they do offer a set already put together with 18 colors for $51.44. So those are, yeah, my battery just died. But there you go, about $35 for this particular set. And they do have other sets at different prices. $35, in my opinion, is definitely worth it. I think that is a really budget-friendly price. It's under the $40, definitely under the $50 price mark, and you get a really high-quality paint. The last time I was in Jerry's, when I bought my individual tubes, you could get them open stock. I think I paid like $2.75 a tube, if I'm not mistaken. They may have fluctuated in price since then, but I don't think so. So definitely worth it, more than a bang for the buck. I really enjoyed these paints, more so than a lot of paints I've used lately. I'm going to be using these on a much, and I thought the Rosa Gallery paints impressed me, but the Rosa Gallery paints tend to have a little bit higher of a price point. Different beasts, different quality paint, really great quality paint, don't get me wrong, but I think that these paints have kind of slid their way into my top five based on the fact that they are what they are quality-wise with that price point. I mean, these are as cheap as White Knights. Cheaper than White Knights, actually. So that's saying a lot. Now, don't get these confused for the regular Marie's Chinese watercolors, the little $5, $6, and $7, $10 sets, or the gouache. Don't get it confused with that. This is specifically the Marie's Masters watercolors. So there you have it, guys. Hopefully you heard something in this review. that will give you a direction as to what you think and whether you want to add these to your art collection. If you did, don't forget to give the video a thumbs up. Please keep in mind that just anything that you like, giving the video a thumbs up helps out a lot. If you care, share the video. It will be more than appreciated. Maybe there's someone out there who would love to hear this information. Use the comment section. Let me know, have you tried these paints? What do you think of them? If you haven't tried them, again, I definitely recommend them and suggest them. Artists of all levels, beginners to experts. Check us out on all of our social media sites. Facebook, TikTok, Instagram, and don't forget about the Thrifty Apprentice sponsored Facebook group, Paints, Pencils, Pastels, and Markers. Everyone's welcome, and it's where we do all things artsy and crafty. We just do it with respect for each other. And yeah, if you want them, go get them. If you want to get somebody a gift that they'll be thankful for and they can learn to use watercolors with a good quality product at a really economical price, go get them. I definitely suggest them. They have made my top five. And remember, as I tell you at the end of every single video, guys, just keep painting and crafting.